Hello, and welcome to RF Design Tutorials, a playlist on my YouTube channel where we talk about practical RF and microwave circuit design. This is tutorial 9 on the topic low noise amplifier design, or what we commonly refer as LNA design. Now, here is a quick agenda for this tutorial. And this tutorial will be in two parts. This is tutorial 9. And in this tutorial, we will go from LNA theory and fundamentals. And then we start with practical RF LNA design flow. And we will finish up to part 1, going over the fundamentals, steps which you need to do in order to create the LNA circuit. We'll talk about DC analysis, how do we do stability network design for circuit like LNA, what we have, as different considerations as a designer which you need to take, and how to make decisions on what are you going to do. And then finally, we'll talk about how to do a proper bias network design for any, amplifier circuit. And then what are the key considerations when you are designing the bias network for any kind of amplifier. So that's where we will finish this video. And then in the next video, which is going to be tutorial 10, we will talk about impedance matching layout, EM simulation, circuit core simulation, nonlinear simulation, verification, and so on. All right, so at the end of part 2 video, which is the next video, we will do performance benchmark about our designed LNA and how do we compare with an off-the-shelf component which is sold by one of the very popular company in the market. So there you will be able to realize all the key steps which we have taken is actually going to make sense in the real world. And you will be able to appreciate how well we did it. Now, the whole idea about creating this video tutorial is to let designers like you gain more design level insights by watching this simple tutorial. And again, as I said, it will be a two-part tutorial, each part approximately 50 minutes or so. And the information which I'm going to present here, you will not find it very easily in any of the textbooks which you might have read till now. And you will be the judge of that. And you tell me by posting your comments in the comment section of this video whether the information presented in this tutorial and the next tutorial was something which you couldn't have found even if you would have spent a lot of time trying to figure out yourself. Right. And again, just one last request, don't skip any of the steps. Just go in a sequence manner, even if the title or the topic looks very elementary to you. Because at every stage, I'm going to give you practical design tips and the practical, implementation tip, which will be very, very useful. That kind of information is not easy at all to find by referring to any textbook or even referring to various papers you might have read on LNA design. All right. Okay, so before we start, quickly subscribe to my channel. Once you subscribe, don't forget to hit the bell icon so that all the notifications get enabled and you are always updated about the new tutorial video post on my YouTube channel. And again, as I said before, if you like the content presented, don't forget to hit the like button. It's very, very important for me and also for the popularity of the video. And feel free to click the share button and share the link of this video in various forums or, list or distribution list you may be a member of, so that wider RF design community gets benefited with the effort. All right, so if you want to pass along my YouTube channel link to your friends and colleagues, feel free to do so. Here's the link for my YouTube channel. All right, so let's quickly start with a review of LNA theory and fundamentals so that we are all synced up at a common level, and then we proceed for our design phase. Have a very good learning experience, my friends, and stay tuned till the end of this tutorial series. Thanks very much for your attention, and let's get started. Now, everybody should know what is LNA, but just for completion's sake, LNA is an electronic amplifier, which, like any other amplifier, amplifies the signal which is fed to its input. However, they are a special class of amplifiers by which they will minimize the noise contribution from the circuit to the input, SNR of the signal. Now, designers can minimize this additional noise contribution by choosing you know, low noise components, selecting the right operating point and selecting the right circuit topologies, which results in the minimum amount of noise, additional noise contribution. Now, while you go after, you know, the noise contribution and make sure you have the best noise performance, you also need to balance, this with other design goals which you may have from an LNA circuit, such as power gain and impedance matching, you know, specification. Now, LNA is a key component of any front end of any radio receiver. It could be mobile phone receiver, base station, your own custom wireless communication, or even radar systems. And the noise figure of the LNA is going to dominate the overall noise figure of the receiver. And the work done by LNA will enable the optimum retrieval of the desired signal in the later stages of the system. So it's one of the very critical components in any receiver design. So you need to put enough attention in making sure you have the best possible LNA, you know, included in your front ends. Now, to understand, about the noise impact of LNA or the performance impact of LNA, take a look at the Frise formula, using which we can calculate the total noise factor of a complete system, where you may have multiple stages, cascaded stages. So this formula shows you that first couple of stages are the main, controlling factor of the overall noise factor. Because after second stage or so, the noise contribution by the subsequent stages will, tend to go down, because the product of the gain of the preceding stages, is in the denominator. So the noise gets divided by the product of the gain. And here is the product gain, not in dB, and also the noise factor is ratio. So the noise factor doesn't have a unit, it's a ratio measurement. And to compute noise figure, we simply take 10 log of the noise factor. And this is what you will see mostly referred in all LNA circuits, or even the specification of the receiver or the front end you may be designing for. So here, when you work with cascaded, system, each stage will add its own noise contribution to the degradation of SNR, which you have at the input. And then correspondingly, it propagates through various chains or various blocks in the system chain, and you have slightly, degraded SNR performance. So the whole idea about, doing a good LNA design is to make sure the noise contribution by the first stage or the second stage, it remains under control, so that overall noise figure of the complete system is well within the limits which we may be looking for. Now, here is the case study specification, which I'm going to use in this tutorial. I picked up an ISM band specification with my center frequency of 2.4 gigahertz plus minus 50 megahertz bandwidth, which is sufficient for all ISM-based communications such as 4G, 5G, or even 3G kind of specification. Now, the gain and the written loss specification, which we want from an LNA, is mentioned here, along with the noise figure. And our target noise figure is less than or equal to 1.4 dB, as we need in LNA. And here are the nonlinear parameters which we want from our LNA circuit. Now, one must be wondering, who decides this specification? Well, the truth is, the system designer, who is responsible for overall system, will employ all these formulas, or he may be using some software like System View when he is doing his receiver architecture. He needs the overall noise figure requirement for the receiver. And then he works out this, stages and does budget calculation and derives this specification of the LNA circuit design here. So here, just assume some system designer has done his study, and he came up with this specification for which we need to do an LNA design. So create no confusion about that. All right. So once you have the specification as a designer, you need to decide how are you going to design it? What process are you going to use it? Now, for practical RF design applications, you do have broadly three choices. You could decide to design LNA using MMIC approach, where we are going to use a gallium arsenide, kind of low noise PHEMT process. We might end up using PCB, MIC, or RF board. they are name of the same thing essentially, but different, you know, designer refer it by different names. So I thought I will mention all of them here. Or you may go to silicon, you know, kind of design approach and use RFIC, you know, design for LNA. On this slide, I have put pros and cons of each of this technology. The main advantage of MMIC or RFIC is the size is going to be very small, few hundred microns, or lower side of maybe 1 to 3 mm² is the typical size you can do your LNA design. However, on the downside is, you know, the cost is going to be very high. If you just need very few circuits, like 10, 20, 50 kind of circuits, then you utilizing MMIC or using fabrication process of RFIC is going to be very expensive, because those processes are mass production friendly. So if you're a company who wants to design thousands or you know, few million pieces, then those technologies are absolutely wonderful for you, because you get mass production and the cost per piece is going to be very small. In this tutorial, to make sure everybody can utilize this tips and tricks and all the knowledge, and in case you want to build your own or design your own LNA, everybody should be able to do that. So I'm picking up, RF board kind of LNA design. However, all the topics, all the theory we are going to talk about is equally applicable for MMIC or RFIC design as well. It's just that depending upon which process you are going to use, you will be bounded by the constraints set by this process. In MMIC or RFIC, you will largely be using a PDK or the library from a specific foundry for a specific process. And all the components which you can use will be specific to that PDK. And each of these components will have its own min and max. So when you design, you need to account for all those min and max, and you come up with a topology which suits that specific technology. And same thing for RFIC. Similarly, in PCB, we have a choice of using either discrete SMT components, or we can use this distributed transmission line based, you know, matching network or circuit design approach. What we end up using depends on largely on the designer specification and the size limitation and the min and max of things which are available in the market for our design. So each technique has pros and cons, and you can go through some of these points in more detail later. All right, so once I decide that I'm going to do RF board design, the first thing I need to look for is a LNA device, a device or a transistor device which I can use to design my LNA. So here in my case study, I'm going to use a ATF21170. It's a pretty old, you know, FET part, originally produced by HP. Then it came to Agilent and then went to Avago and then eventually to Broadcom. Now this device is 0.5 to 6 gigahertz. It's a low noise gallium arsenide FET. So you can use this component, or nowadays you have much better devices available, which is based on PHEMT process that gives you even better noise figure performance. Now, because as a designer, I have used this design, so I find myself more comfortable. So I'm going to use this device for my demonstration. Now, the key things you need to look at while selecting any device. Number one, the device frequency range should cover your application frequency. So in my case, I want to work with 2.4 gigahertz, and this device goes from, you know, 0.5 to 6 gigahertz, so perfect match. The second key specification, the device inherently should have optimum noise figure, which is much lesser than what you are expecting from your LNA. Now, if you remember my specification, I wanted 1.4 dB from my LNA circuit. So the device which I'm going to pick should be less than 1.4 dB for sure, around the frequency I am going to design it for. Now, good thumb rule to remember, you should pick a device whose optimum noise figure, or what we also call as NF minimum, is less than or equal to half of your target device, you know, noise figure from the LNA circuit. So in my case, I wanted 1.4 dB. So I'm going to pick a device which is less than half of that. So in this here, around 2 gigahertz is around 0.6. So it meets that criteria. Right. Another key specifications to look for is the gain at your frequency and also the PWM-dB from the device, because you need to match all these specifications. Okay, now other things which you can look in the data sheet of any transistor is about noise parameter. and specifically on a bias level you want to use that device for. And in case the specification is not mentioned on your bias level, you can always talk to vendor and obtain these parameters on the specific DC bias level you want to use. And it's basically these noise parameters, like five columns. You have frequency, minimum possible noise figure from that device, and the gamma optimum magnitude and angle, which if you match the device with this gamma, you are going to get the best possible noise figure, and the noise resistance, which is sensitivity of how the noise figure will degrade due to the impedance mismatch you are going to have in the device. All right. Now, once you select a device, you need to look at what kind of model you have available to do your LNA design. So if you're lucky, or if a vendor provides you a nonlinear model, you can obtain that library from the vendor for ADS. Add that library, and I already have covered a previous tutorial video on how to work with vendor library components. So you can use that approach, add the library in your design, and then you can start using the parts from that library. And with the nonlinear model, you will be able to simulate both linear as well as nonlinear performance from your LNA. Sometimes vendors do not give you a nonlinear model. They actually give you an S2P file. Now, that S2P file should have a noise data included inside. So here is one example. It's not the same device as what you see here. It's some other BJT kind of device here. I'm just using it to explain how this file looks like. If you open that file, you will have a regular S parameter data over frequency. And at the bottom, you also have this noise data. And this noise data is nothing but the same data which I described here. Your frequency, noise figure, gamma optimum magnitude and angle, and the noise resistance. And that's what you have here. All right. So it's very important to have an S2P file with the noise data if you want to use it for LNA design. Now, with this S2P file, including noise data, you would be able to characterize all the linear specification, and you can simulate and obtain S11 gain, S22 noise figure. However, you cannot simulate P1 dB and IP3. Just be mindful of that. However, those are not showstopper specification from LNA, because when you look at the data sheet, you also get P1 dB. And again, you can ask vendor to give you P1 dB at your frequency, at your own bias level. And as long as you have little bit of margin of what P1 dB you need and what your device can offer you based on your frequency and the bias condition, it's fine. You can just go ahead and do an amplifier design. You don't need to sweat over these two specifications. You need to assume it will work. If you still want to characterize it, somehow you need to have a device model. Either vendor can give you, or you can use your own device modeling platform to do the device modeling. All right, one last thing before we go into practical design example and walk through each of the step. There's a special impedance matching considerations in LNA, which is slightly different than how you do, power amplifiers or medium power amplifiers. And that's about how do you manage the input impedance matching network of LNA. Remember that gamma optimum, which is the best possible reflection coefficient for your noise performance, it not necessarily equal to the best gain match or simultaneous conjugate match. That means they will always be different more often than not. And the whole skill of a good LNA designer is to balance out these two performance where your noise do not degrade too much and your return loss doesn't suffer too much in order to obtain each other elements. So you need to have a decent enough impedance match. That means you should have a good S11. At the same time, your noise figure should be within control or what system designer has given you. So the whole skill revolves around this. And again, as we go into tutorial, we will talk about more and what are the different ways designer can work their way through and come up with the right topology or the right compromising point. Just remember that your matching circuit design will often limit the ability of amplifier to achieve a specific noise figure, which is closer to what device inherently can give you. So it's all about balancing the performance. And the same kind of concept is also applicable for power amplifier designers, but not in the input side, but on the output matching network side. And that's where you need to compromise between your S22 and the output power delivery. And we will talk about it once we go into power amplifier design tutorial. All right, with this theory and fundamental, we are all set to start our practical RF design flow discussion. I'll walk over each of these parts in a greater detail, one by one, in a sequential manner. And again, I would recommend you not to skip any step, and make sure you stay tuned with each of these topics, because almost in every topic, we will have some practical tip to worry about, and I will make sure you have that practical tip, and then you can use it for your own circuit design. So enjoy the rest of the learning, and don't forget to leave your valuable comment after you watch, finish this tutorial, and make sure you share the link with your friends and colleagues and subscribe to my channel. Okay, stay tuned and have a good learning experience. Okay, let's start with part one of our practical RF circuit design analysis flow. And in part one, we are going to talk about DC analysis stability network and a bias network design. So in order to demonstrate, I already have the ADS workspace here with all the steps involved. So in the first step, we are going to look at DC IV characteristics. Now, before we go and start talking about any of these design, the first thing we need to do is add the nonlinear model, right? So in one of the earlier tutorial video, which I posted on my YouTube channel, I talked about how to work with vendor library components. So in order to, get ATF21170, if you want to use that device, that library ships with ADS. So we can go to Design Kits, click on Unzip Design Kit, and from the available menu, we can go to C drive, Program Files, Key Site. That's where your ADS gets installed. Now, depending upon which ADS version you may be using, you can go to that installation folder. And under that installation folder, if you look at OA Libs, which basically is Open Access Libraries, inside this, you will have a component library, and all the zipped file of the component libraries will be posted here. So the transistor I'm looking at is available under RF Transistor Vendor Kit. So I'm going to unzip this library and add it into my workspace. Once I select, click open, it will ask for a destination folder to unarchive. Once you select the folder, it will unzip the design kit. Now, in my case, I already have this library added to my workspace. That's why I see this message saying it's already exists. Do you want to overwrite? In your case, if you're doing it for the first time, it will not give you this message. It will simply ask you, do you want to add it in your workspace? And once you select yes, this library will get added into your ADS. Now, if I open this schematic, I have inserted a DC FET curve tracer template. And remember, in one of the earlier videos, we already talked about it. So we go to Insert Template and look at the various templates which we have available. And here in my case, I'm using FET curve tracer. If you're using BJT device for your design, you can always use BJT. The FET curve tracer works for both MESFET, HEMS, as well as MOSFETs. So no matter what device you have. Once I have the template in place, I have placed this component. So assume there is no component and there's just template. How do I get my part here? I can go to library browser if I click on this icon, or I can just simply press I on my keyboard. And under read only libraries, you will have RF transistor library, which we just added. And this library contains various parts. So while I select RF transistor from the search menu, I can type ATF, and now I can see all the devices here. And my ATF21170 device is here. To place it on the schematic, I can just simply drag and drop it to the schematic, and you have the part. Or I could simply select the device. So let's say here again, ATF. And once I select the device, I can right click and select place component, whatever works better for you. So once I have component ready for placement, I'm going to connect it to my circuit. And again, let me move this text slightly here. So I have a gate bias, which is set for -1 to 0 volt sweeping in a step of 0.1, and the drain voltage getting swept from 0 to 5 volt. We can go ahead and run the simulation, and we can observe the IV characteristics of this transistor. Now, you can see there are multiple colors, but in your case, all the colors may be all red. And in order to enable this multicolor so that each color represents one gate voltage level, you can double click on the trace. Don't double click on the graph, but double click on the trace. And now you can switch on the line color. Once you switch on the line color, you will have this multicolor traces. Now for any practical LNA operation, we need to bias it on class A mode, because class A, you have the highest possible linearity. And that's what we are looking from our LNA design. We are not too much bothered about the efficiency of the amplifier. And when your efficiency becoming your prime concern, you start to play with the class AB and class C and class DE and all those kind of operation. But those are more valid for power amplifiers, not for LNA. So for LNA, I simply place my marker around the class A operating point, and I can see it's 3 volts of the drain supply. And VGS is corresponding to -0.4 volt. And here is the operating condition and the power consumption by my LNA device. And that's good enough. So that's my step number one. Now, if I'm using an S parameter file from the vendor, this step cannot be done because you already have an S parameter file, which is already extracted at a particular bias level. So in that case, you directly can go to step two. And so if you have a nonlinear model, we perform IV characteristics first. Now in step two, and again, I already covered that in my previous S parameter simulation of active circuits in a tutorial video. Here I have a very simple S parameter test bench with an ideal DC block and DC feed, which basically acts as my coupling capacitor and a choke, and they are ideal in nature, so they do not load my device. I set up an S-parameter simulation, and I know this device is going to be operating from 0.5 gigahertz till 6 gigahertz. So that's how I set up a sweep. And to check the stability of the device from the S-parameter, template simulation S-parameter, you do have approaches of stability measure and stability factor, or you could use mu and mu prime. And I think in the earlier tutorial, I already covered all these things in greater detail. So I prefer using mu and mu prime, and I set up an S parameter simulation. And let me show you what happens. Let me disable this options block. Now, along with checking stability, I might also need to take a look at the noise figure produced by this device. And to enable noise calculation, I can double click on the controller, go to noise tab and switch on calculate noise. So this along with S parameter will also compute all my noise parameter. So let's go ahead and run analysis. Now before we look at the result, see what ADS simulation status window shows. It says simulation temperature of 25 degree is not the same as per IEEE standard. Because in IEEE definition, whenever you're doing noise calculation, the temperature should be 290 Kelvin, or the, in terms of degree centigrade, it should be 16.85. And that's what you need to use in order to get the right results. However, it doesn't change your noise figure results by a great amount. But just to make sure we are qualifying with all the criteria, we place this options block, which you can see here in the library palette. Under option block, we define the simulation temperature as indicated in the status window, 16.85. Now, with this option block enabled, if I go and run simulation, I will not see that warning again. Okay, this warning can be ignored because this is referring to the large signal model of my device or the nonlinear model. Now, here is your result. And if you look at your gain, it's around 14 dB, but the stability factor is less than 1 for both mu as well as mu prime, indicating very clearly that my device is unstable across the entire frequency range, especially on my working frequency of 2.4 gigahertz. If you look at the noise figure now, and when you look at the results available, you have the regular S parameter results. You have a gamma optimum in case you want to see what reflection coefficient or what impedance you have to present to device in order to get the best possible noise figure. We will do that once we go to impedance matching portion of the video. But you also get this NF, which is your noise figure, and 2 means output noise figure. That's what is your actual noise figure of the LNA. And I have plotted both of them, NF minimum, which is, if you remember my PPT slide, is actually the minimum noise figure which your device will be able to produce, assuming you match the impedance to, you know, gamma optimum or S optimum. All right. So now if you look at this plot, the minimum noise figure on my bias level and my frequency, it's around 0.2 dB. But the actual circuit noise figure based on the 50 ohm termination, which I placed and I haven't done any impedance matching, is around 0.6 dB. Now, whether reported in result or not, noise figure results always would be in dB in ADS. So you don't need to do any extra manipulation. Now, what's our next step? Now, if I have an unstable device, there's no point continuing with my LNA circuit design. I need to first stabilize the device. Now, let's go and talk about how can we stabilize the device and what are the typical techniques at my disposal. Now, here in this circuit, if I have to stabilize the device, basically, the easiest way to think about it is I need to introduce certain resistive component in my design here. So one of the ways you can achieve the stability is you have these two locations, one at the input, one at the output, and you can place a resistor component, for example, right? So you place a resistor component at the input, and let me just wire it up here, and then let me not place, or let me just copy paste this resistor again at the output side. And let's do the wiring. But for my simulation purpose, I would just deactivate this resistor. So let's say if I place a resistor and I know I cannot place a 50 ohm because this will suck up a lot of my power. So let's say I place 15 ohm, you know, kind of resistor at the input. And now if I run simulation, I can check whether my stability got improved. And if I place a new marker at my frequency, of around, you know, 2.4 gigahertz, definitely it seems my stability factor is greater than 1. But look at what happened to noise figure. So your noise figure rose to 1.7 dB, which is much worse than my expectation because my spec is 1.4 dB for the entire LNA, and I haven't yet decided to do impedance matching and all that. Look at the gain. Gain suffered by almost like 1.5 dB. And I see a reduction, but not that bad. However, the noise impact is very, very high. Now, what's the next approach? So one tip to remember, whenever you're dealing with LNA, never include any lossy component at the input of your LNA. If you have to include any resistor or whatever, especially in series, you should always include it on the output side. Because remember the fundamental of the Friis formula. The noise contribution by this guy will get divided by the gain produced by this device when you try to consider the SNR degradation. So this gain will compensate, you know, up to a certain extent, whatever noise this guy is going to produce. Okay, so if I place some output resistor, let's say 50 ohm, we run simulation, and suddenly, sorry about that, this is not open circuit, this is short circuit, let's short it, and we run simulation. Now you can see I achieve you know, stability more than 1, which is good. But look at a noise figure. It doesn't got degraded by that amount, right? It's only 0.7 dB from 0.6 dB to 0.7 dB. So it's pretty good. I achieve stability. However, look at the gain, and gain got dropped to 10.8 dB, which is not good because my target gain is minimum 14 dB. So that's not pretty good. So while this technique is allowing me to stabilize the device, but my gain is getting eaten up due to this resistor. So not a very optimum, you know, technique. Now, what else option you have? So first thing, which is very clear from this analysis, that I need to reduce this value. So if I reduce it to 20 ohm and then run a simulation, I can see the gain is almost there, but then 20 ohm doesn't stabilize the device properly. Noise figure is pretty good because I am not touching the input side anyway. So, but this is kind of main concern. Plus, when you're looking at stability, you have two ways to look at it. One, certain set of designers prefer, you know, or for them it is sufficient as long as the device is stabilized within the band they are going to operate on. And even if there is a slight instability outside their band, they don't worry about it. They only do in-band stability kind of matching. That's called conditional stability design process. But in a larger sense, if you want to play safer, you would like the device to be stabilized across the frequency band of operation, at least till the point where your device has gain greater than 1, right? Or greater than 0 in terms of dB. 1 is in linear terms. So if you are able to stabilize device in the entire frequency band, then you are free to do whatever you want. You are not worried about the device going into or circuit going into instability region. But whenever you deal with conditional stability, that means you're only stabilizing within your frequency range, you are recommended to plot load stability circles and a source stability circle to make sure you don't venture into that unstable region while doing your impedance matching or selecting the operating point of the device to achieve the gain or the noise figure match. All right, so what option can we do? Well, you can play, so right now we just played with the shunt component, you can, series component, you can place resistors in shunt and try out various topologies. Now, if you're an MMIC designer, if you're doing an MMIC, a very common technique which is used in MMIC is to provide a feedback. And there they use a RLC kind of network in the feedback of this device. Now, as you understand from your theory, feedback is a good way of killing by providing the negative feedback, killing the oscillation. Also, it helps you in increasing the bandwidth of your circuit. The biggest drawback by that approach, however, is your gain will drop significantly. If you are designing for RF board, you cannot afford that, although there is nobody stopping you in using the feedback concept to achieve the stability. But the gain will drop so much that you will need probably 2 stages of amplifier or 3 stages of amplifier. Now, when your one stage itself might be 1 inch or 1.5 inch, if you end up doing 3-stage LNA design on an RF board or MIC, that will be counterproductive. It's not going to help you because you end up with a very big circuit. However, in MMICs, that's not a problem because everything is so small and you're dealing with few microns. You can always sacrifice one stage to achieve the stability and the bandwidth which you're looking for. And then you add 1 or 2 more gain stages to achieve the overall gain of 14 dB, 15 or 20 dB, as you may be looking for. Again, as I said, the techniques and the theory remains the same. Just depending upon which process are you going to use, you just need to modulate yourself a little bit and apply the fundamentals accordingly. All right, so let me show you when I'm able to achieve all the stability, and that's step number 3. And in the step number 3, we already talked about the series resistor. So I finalized on 15 ohm. And then I connected a shunt RC network to avoid, to provide some resistive loading to my device. And again, I took attention or proper care by making sure this value is as high as possible to achieve the stability, plus not letting the gain or the noise figure degrade too much. Right, this capacitor is only doing a job of blocking the DC going to the ground because I want this DC to directly go to the device instead of going anywhere else. And the same job is done by this DC block capacitor as well. You don't want this DC to go and interfere with your RF, rather go and bias this particular device. Now, with this stability network, if I run simulation, you can notice all across the frequency band, my mu and mu prime both are greater than 1. Now, sometime I get a question, how much it should be above 1? Is 1.008 okay, 1.01 okay, or should I go for at least 1.5? Doesn't matter. As long as you are over than 1 with a little bit of margin, your device is stabilized. Now, because you have a broadband stability, now you are in an unconditionally stable zone. And now your amplifier design will be much, much easier job to manage because for any kind of impedance matching application, you have the whole Smith chart available for you and you are free to use whatever matching location you want to use. If you are doing conditional stability, you need to be again careful. plot load stability circle, source stability circles, and then you need to make sure you are not inside those unstable region. Now, what is a noise figure impact? Well, it had a slightly more impact, which I expected, because now I have a resistor at the input of this transistor. However, within the given constraint that I can't use feedback, I cannot let my gain go much worse by increasing this resistor value. This is right now is the best possible combination I could come up with. And this will work differently for different devices. If you pick any other device, you might need to come up with a different kind of stability network, which will work for you. All right. So this is my step number two completed, the response of the stabilized device. And gain is 12.5. Not so bad, because once I do impedance matching, I can definitely increase it by around 2.5 to 3 dB for sure. So which will meet my criteria of greater than 14 dB. I still have around 0.2, 0.3 dB of noise figure margin to account for any mismatch loss or the loss of the input matching network, which will affect my noise figure performance. And again, later, once we have more pieces in place, I can balance out rest of the specs. All right. So this is where, we finished our step number two. Finally, in step number three, we need to do a bias network design. So don't go over this step four, because this is ideally step number two. But I just created step two to show you the stability problem. All right, in step number three, we need to do a bias network, because now we need to feed this DC bias. And that bias network should work at my RF frequency, which is currently 2.4 gigahertz, for which I'm designing. So what choices designer have? So choice number one, you could use a choke approach, especially if you're in low frequency. Choke is a very popular way of doing the bias network design. However, if you are working in higher frequencies, the choke availability is not possible, right? So what we do in higher frequency is we use lambda by four, high impedance transformer case. And we design our bias network using high impedance lambda by four, bias network. So let's take a look at the bias network design here. So here in this schematic, I'm going to use a Rogers 20 mil substrate, 3.6 is dielectric constant with a loss tangent of width E minus 4 and 35 micron metal thickness. And let me enable all these components first. And let me enable this S parameter controller. Now, in terms of bias network, I can use a line calc. Remember, in the previous videos, we talked about the line calc operation. Using line calc on this dielectric stack up, I calculated the width and the length of my high impedance lambda by four line. So lambda by four, or 90 degree line at 2.4 gigahertz, came out to be 19.8 mm. And the width of the line, remember we talked about in impedance matching video, 0.2 mm width gives 105 ohms of resistance. So that's good enough for me to have an inductive line or a high impedance line of 0.2 mm. And again, the width of this line doesn't matter in case of LNA. I can even go lower as long as my PCB fab house can fabricate it, because LNAs are not a high power device. That means they are not drawing a very high current and drain like a power amplifier. So I have no problem in chipping off the conductors or burning off the conductors around or anything of that sort. So I selected that option. So that's a step number one. Step number two, remember this line eventually has to go and connect to anything before that and after that. So I just have a 50 ohm line, small segments, 1 to 2 mm, it's up to you what you want to pick. But just that it is 50 ohm. And I have a proper discontinuity modeling here, because this is 0.2 mm. And on the dielectric I'm using here, my 50 ohm line width is 1.1 mm. And again, that is calculated using line calc. So I have a discontinuity properly modeled here, with width 1, width 2, W50, which is 50 ohm, and WDC, which is this DC feed line. All right. Now, another practical aspect, you may have tons of bypass capacitors, which you are going to place because this is your DC feed point, and your DC bias will go through this lambda by 4 line and eventually reaching the FET. And a lot of time I've seen, designers, they just include this capacitor and connect the ground and specify 470 picofarad or 560 picofarad kind of capacitor. However, it's a good thing to remember that these capacitors will have footprint on the PCB, and that footprint will have certain physical size. And the concept on which this lambda by 4 line is working, it is assuming a ground at this point or short at this point. Because once it is short circuit at this point, this lambda by 4 impedance transformer will convert it to open circuit at this point here. So that when you have RF signal coming in, C is perfect open circuit and the entire RF energy goes into the FET device here. Now, any additional line here might disturb that calculation because now your ground is here, not here. So while doing this modeling, and again, the way I model it, again, different designers do differently. How I model it is by simple three sections. So I have one capacitor pad of like 0.5 mm and another capacitor pad 0.5 mm, and there is a gap in between. So this models a capacitor footprint. So if I open the layout of this schematic, you could probably realize what I'm saying. So if you remember, this is like a classical SMT footprint. So you have one kind of pad, and then you have a gap, and then you have another pad, and that's where you mount your SMT component. And this is what this guy is doing. So it allows me, this kind of modeling allows me to take parasitic produced by this pad into account, as well as we are using the M step here to account for the impedance discontinuity, because this is 0.2 mm, and this pad width will depend on the size of capacitor I'm going to use. So in my case, I'm using 0603 capacitor size. So the pad width I calculated as 45 mil, because 0603 means 30 mil wide, capacitor. And I'm just going 1.5x as usually recommended by various QA people or assembly people. So 45 mil. So to account for that impedance discontinuity, I also have this M step. Now, if I run S parameter simulation, and if this line is transparent at my frequency, then this 50 ohm, this is 50 ohm, that's 50 ohm, that's 50 ohm. So I should see a beautiful return loss, matching at 2.4 gigahertz, because that's where all this calculation is coming about. Let's see. Let's run the simulation and let's look at this response. Now here, if you look at S11 and S22 response, you get a perfect null in terms of matching at 2.4 gigahertz, indicating the shunt line is totally transparent. Also, even if you are doing at a spot frequency, if you look at 20 dB or better than 20 dB return loss, that means you have virtually less than 1% energy leaking into the shunt line. And if you put a marker here to note the 20 ohms, so you can see it's from 1.8 gigahertz right up to around 3 gigahertz. So that itself is giving you good enough bandwidth to play with. Right. So you don't need to do anything more, even if you are doing an amplifier design for something like this bandwidth on 2.4 gigahertz, which is pretty good. Now, if you look at the transmission loss, of course, because it's all transparent, so you'll have a very less transmission response. Now, the lambda by 4 line, which you have at 2.4 gigahertz, will be lambda by 2 at 4.8 gigahertz. And that's why you see a perfect kind of short circuit, because you have a ground here, and at double the frequency, this is lambda by 2 going to short. So if you have any harmonic coming in to the amplifier, will get grounded. It won't reach your amplifier, so don't worry about that. And similarly, if you see S21 response at your 4.8 gigahertz, you have a very high rejection from input to output. So this lambda by 4 line serves both purpose. It helps you to get rid of second harmonic performance, even if the second harmonic got generated by a FET, because the same bias network will also go at the output of the FET structure in LNA. Right? So that's how it is. Now, in case you mess up this line a little bit, and let's say you did a wrong calculation, let's say if it is 12.8 mm And if I run the simulation, of course, my performance gets degraded, as you can see here. It's not as high, finely tuned at 2.4 gigahertz, and the write frequency got shifted somewhere higher. Yeah, which is, of course, because I reduced the length, so the resonance got shifted at the higher frequency. And again, because of this, the second harmonic will be now over 7 gigahertz, and you will have a rejection somewhere down there. But this is not good because I have sufficient amount of energy now leaking into the bias network, and it's not a very good design practice. So pay a very, very special attention on your bias network design, because each small piece will eventually give you the impact when you deal with the overall LNA circuit design. So let me correct that. Let's re-simulate, and this is what we are able to obtain. Now, sometime if you're not sure how many capacitors you will end up putting at the, you know, after amplifier fabrication or whatever, and if you're looking for double protection and, you know, protecting yourself from any unseen impact. So you will often see in various publications what people do here. You can put a T junction here, and then from the microstrip transmission line library, you could use something like a radial stub. And this radial stub is like giving you a double protection to anything which happens here. Because remember, we talked about how the short circuit was expected at this point, and then you have an open circuit here. But sometime if you mess up this entire calculation, here is your, you know, fallback option. If you have this radial stub, which is again going to be lambda by 4 length and the frequency you want, and the angle can be decided because this radial stub will give you slightly more bandwidth than a typical transmission line. And if you're doing, you know, wider band amplifier design, this could help you doing that. So open circuit, because radial stub is like an open circuit stub. So open circuit here, and if it is lambda by 4, will create a short circuit here. Then it doesn't matter what happens here, because everything will get short circuited at this point. And this short circuit will enable this lambda by 4 line to produce an open circuit at that point. Right, so it serves both the purpose. Now, if you need even more protection, you can always do a butterfly stub. That means you can place two radial stubs, one on the either side. And I have even seen designers do that for a variety of applications. Again, more broadband designs you do, more protection you start taking. Higher the frequency you design LNA for, better is the job which you need to do in order to do that. Well, that's all about, you know, managing your bias network with all practical constraints, and hope this tip will help you coming out with a good bias network design. All right, so let me disable some of these parts. And as you can see, I have 3 pins here, because eventually I want to use this as a sub-circuit in a top-level design. And I have named them as IP, OP, and DC feed, so that then I can identify those terminals properly later in my design process. Well, this ends the first part of our RF design flow. Let's quickly summarize what we learned in part one of this tutorial exercise. In part one, we started by adding a nonlinear component from the library to our workspace. We used that ATF21170 part and running a DC IV characteristic simulation. We decided the bias to be a class A operation of the amplifier, as more recommended for LNA design. Based on that bias point, we went ahead and set up an S parameter simulation like we do for any active circuit. We looked at the stability along with the noise parameters like noise figure and F minimum and rest of the S parameters, which we usually do. We then put our attention on how to stabilize the device, and we went for unconditional stability network design, and we looked at various options, and we selected one option which seemed to be working for our LNA circuit. Now, after our device was stabilized, we turned our attention to do bias network design. And in this case, we talked about high impedance lambda by 4. Bias network design and all the key considerations you need to take while designing that kind of network. We also touched upon how to do a proper component footprint modeling so that we can take those parasitics into account while designing our bias network to make sure we have the right, you know, short circuit and the open circuit positions. We also touched upon, you know, the utility of using radial stub or a butterfly stub to ensure that, you know, there's always a proper open circuit on our RF frequencies to ensure the RF circuit doesn't, RF energy doesn't get leaked into the bias network design, and we can have a proper LNA operation. So that finishes this tutorial. I hope you thoroughly enjoyed your learning experience till now, and I was able to give you some useful tips along the way, which will help you in your circuit design. And now, in tutorial 10, we are going to extend the same learning which we did and, you know, do rest of the topics as listed here. And then finally do a full, you know, amplifier, as you can see on this picture. And then once we are done, we will do performance benchmark with an off-the-shelf LNA component sold by, you know, one of the companies in the market. And then we will see how well we did it against these commercial parts. All right, so thanks again at the end, and thanks for staying till the end of this tutorial. Don't forget to hit the like button, put the comment in the comment section below, and feel free to share this video link with all your friends and colleagues and post it on various LinkedIn or other forums you may be a member of. Thanks a lot, my friends, and look forward to see you in tutorial 10.